So second session after lunch. Please don't sleep off. I'll try to keep you engaged as much as possible. So today, I'm Vinodhini, and I'll be talking about fake review detection, some of the challenges that we face, and then framework and the future of identifying or automating the process of fake review detection. So, yeah, so I'm going to start with a very traditional quote where I think all of us must be very familiar with this quote, must have come across a lot of times. This quote was by a very famous professor and statistician. He was also the father of total quality management, where he said, "In God we trust, but everybody else should bring data." But I have a small change to it. I think Dr. Edwards, when he made this quote 60 years back, he was very optimistic. So he thought that all the data that is there or available can be trusted, right? So apparently that's not the case these days, especially with the online e-commerce picking up and the ecosystem that we have online. So we cannot trust all that is there. So I'd like to change this a bit, if I may. And so I'd like to say, in God we trust, but please give us authentic data. So with that, that sets the context for my discussion for the next 20 to 25 minutes. So we are going to be talking about how fake reviews are becoming an increasing problem. And do we have any frameworks to identify them as such? And how are online players like Amazon, TripAdvisor, or Zomato, or any other review platform where you have a lot of volume of reviews coming in, deal with this problem of fake reviews? So I'll start with the agenda for today. I'll start with the importance of online reviews and some of the challenges in identifying the fake reviews as humans, as well as in doing a bit of machine learning. And then I'll discuss upon some of the NLP features or techniques that can be used to identify these fake reviews, and also be discussing upon a very general framework for identifying them. Yeah, so why are reviews so important, right? So the stats are there. So 68% of millennials always go through online reviews before they make a purchase. And so consumer reviews are significantly more trusted, 12 times more than any other reviews that we have. And then negative reviews create a buzz. And then positive reviews sometimes boost your sales. Sometimes negative reviews also give you a brand recognition if you're not well known. And there's a lot of sentiment that goes around when there is a negative review about a brand. Say, for example, Maggie. 3 years back, there was a report saying that Maggie has a component in it which is not healthy to consume, right? So that created a big buzz, and there was a lot of dip in the sales of Maggie product, and it was also into the verge of closing down the product altogether. So taking it out of the market, I mean. So this makes it very important for us to understand why fake reviews are important. Now let's look at what is the impact of a positive review vis-a-vis a negative review. So when we talk about positive reviews, for every star that a business gets, there is a 5 to 9% increase in the business revenue. And so given an equal pricing, right? So for we look up for places before we visit a place, we look for places for accommodation and stay. So there we can see that 3.9 times people are likely to choose when they have a review rating of more than 4 vis-a-vis a rating less than 4, given the price is the same. So this means that we are no longer concerned about the price, but we rely more upon the reviews that are getting posted online. So this is the impact of a positive review. And 72% of the consumers also say that positive reviews makes them to trust their businesses more. So let's look at some of the problems with negative reviews. So what happens when you post a negative review? So negative reviews, on an average, I'd like to highlight here is the fourth one. So a single negative review can cost you 30 consumers. So imagine this, if this is the case with small businesses, so then this is going to impact their business, their revenue and sales or even their brand name to a great extent. And so negative reviews in Google search can also result you to cost 70% of your potential consumer. So this is the impact that we're talking about, the reviews that get posted online, and why it has become very important for businesses to actually identify the reviews that are actually getting posted on their web pages are authentic or are they fake, right? So this brings me to the next. Businesses which are very much in the industry, I mean, which rely a lot, where the businesses rely a lot on online reviews. So the first one is a restaurant or a cafe, food industry basically, and hotel and B&B. So that is again your stay. And then we have healthcare. So this is an interesting statistic that we got, that 31% of 31% is the impact that these reviews have on the reviews business. So I'll take up a few cases on how and why it is important in case of restaurant and in terms of healthcare. So if you see a restaurant with a rating which is just on a scale of 1 to 5, is likely to be full on all peak times, and it is also we can also see that some sort of demographic information is also relevant when we look at restaurants. So whenever 61% have read their, 53% of 18 to 23 year olds report that online reviews factor into their decisions for going to or visiting a restaurant. So I know this is too much of stats, but then, yeah. So coming to the health sector, we can see that, so now we are at a point where we also look up for doctors online. So websites like Practo have made it easy for us to make an appointment online and also search for doctors or specialists in a given area. So are we, can we trust all the reviews by that's been posted by Practo or posted by people on the Practo platform? That's a big question. So especially when we have, so healthcare, the impact is very high, right? So if you go to a restaurant and if your food is bad, you might be a very unhappy customer. That's it. But when you go to a doctor who's not specialized in the area, or in fact, you go to a fake doctor, so what happens? The implications are really high, right? So can you trust all these online reviews? So people say, so this was a very recent survey. So they say that 84% of the consumers, they trust the online reviews as much as their consultation or discussion with a peer or a friend. So this is a alarmingly high number, so it's almost 80%. So this also has become a recent problem where there is an increase of fake doctors or fake practitioners coming up into Practo, and they do not have the right degree, they do not have the right skills to treat a particular problem, but they are there upon Practo and other websites, just to quote a few. So yeah, so just one more slide on stats. So how many of us know that almost out of the one-third of all the reviews that you see online are fake, right? So 1 in 7 TripAdvisor reviews can be fake. And then 61% of electronics that are sold on Amazon are fake. And the highest category of goods in Amazon is Bluetooth headphones and Bluetooth earphones. So 70% of the reviews that are posted for these products are fake. So this is something which Amazon has also published in their recent report, and TripAdvisor has also, they also have a transparency report where they have mentioned the extent of these fake reviewers on their web pages and how they are, what measures they have taken to improve or weed off these reviews before they get posted, before they get public on their portal and after they get public as well. So they have at least 180 variables to identify if the review is fake or not. Okay, so let's do some jargon check. So this was fairly new to me when I started the research as well. So yeah, sorry, I think the names are not coming up. So the first one is sock puppeting, and the next is crowd turfing, and the next is astroturfing, and the last one is review brushing. So any of us know what sock puppeting is? Okay, so it's very, I think we must have all seen it. Sock puppeting is a person with a sock and then a puppet, and then he impersonates. So there's actually one person, but it's seemingly two. So that's called sock puppeting. It's a very common jargon, you can say, not a term that is used in the field of or the research of fake reviews. So that is one. So impersonate. So seemingly there is only one person who's posting all the reviews, but then when you look at it, there are 10 people. It looks like 10 people, but it's actually one person who's posting upon it. So that's sock puppeting. And then crowd turfing. So crowd turfing is something which we, where actually these vendors, actually vendors from Amazon or even the companies itself, hire a group of people to post reviews and from different parts of the world. So the way they have spoofed the entire system is unimaginable. So the extent to which they have gone to do this crowd turfing. And astroturfing is just a different term. It's that's what they call in Canada, and crowd turfing in China and rest of the world. So yeah, so you can actually pretty much pay users people to post a bogus review. And the last one is review brushing. So review brushing, what is that comes to your mind? Do you think it's a way of identifying or verifying the review is fake or not, or do you think it's another jargon for fake reviews? Can I have a hands up for if you think it's an authentic way of verifying reviews? So the name is review brushing. Guys, please. Yes, everybody else thinks it's another way of faking. Okay, so review brushing is very interesting. So this concept, how it works is, you basically have creating orders. So there's also some sort of identity theft which is involved there. So you pick up some person's address and you ship a product to him. Right? You can be a vendor or you can be just one of the suppliers. So you basically kind of pick up your product seemingly, and then you post it, you kind of make a purchase, and you have a different delivery address. But then the people who to whom the product is shipped to usually end up with an empty box, right? So, but they did not even make the purchase in the first place, but they're getting an empty box. So this actually comes up as a, so the person who has received the product will not be able to go back and post a review saying that I have received an empty box, because he doesn't know from where the product came from. So once this product gets delivered according to Amazon or any other seller place, what they do is they write a phony review. So this is what they call as review brushing. So I thought I'll discuss upon some of these terms that are used in, so the different ways of creating fake reviews. So that's about it. And so first we have to look at the human learning approach. So let's see if we are able to identify if these two reviews, out of these two reviews, which is seemingly fake and which is seemingly authentic, right? So let's go by the first one. So these two are reviews for a hotel in Chennai, and it's for the same hotel. So if you look the one on the left side, it seems more authentic because you also have a reviewer name, and also you have the number of contributions that he has made, and the number of helpful votes he has received. And he also has a very seemingly good English that's written. And so that's pretty much about it. So this seems more seemingly authentic, right? Whereas on the right side, we also have another review, a negative review, which says, so this person's location, if you first see, he is basically from Chennai. And if you look at the reviews that he has posted, he has posted about an experience of his stay in the hotel. So the first question that comes to our mind is, for a person who stays in Chennai, what is the need for him to post about a reservation that he made in Chennai? There is no mention about somebody else has stayed in the place, right? And also another thing which we can identify using the contents that we have here is, so if we have a large number of, I mean, if we have a large variation between the date of stay there, here, versus the date in which the review was posted. So that could also act as an indicator of if the review was fake or not. So this is seemingly very genuine when you look at it in the first place. But when you look at the location plus the review as in itself, we can, to a certain extent, say that this doesn't seem to be authentic. So this is, so the way I say human learning here is because we as individuals have a lot of challenges. This is not like any other task where we can automate, like machine learning, where you have a forecasting problem and then you can identify it, right? Where the human learning component is not necessary to a great extent. But here, human learning is also very important because we are the ones who are going to annotate these reviews as positive or, fake or not fake. Right? So, one more thing. So this is another challenge. So can we just quickly go through this and can we say if this is a fake review or not? People who's a fan of Tom Hanks or who follows English movies. So this is a review about the movie Captain Sally. So is this authentic or a fake review? Fake, right? So can you think this can be automated? Okay, how many of us don't think this is a fake? How many of us know? I mean, for those of us who have not watched the movie, does this seem authentic? Right? So the review is about a movie, extremely loud and incredibly noisy, something like extremely noisy, incredibly loud, yeah. So the actors, the cast, everything is the same, and there is also a boy called Oscar. Everything is correct, but then the movie name is wrong, right? So this is a content-related spam or a fake review, right? And why fake review reduction is becoming a huge challenge is because the content that you post is completely unrelated to the product in review or the movie in review. So yeah, so these are some of the challenges. So there is one story which I'd like to highlight upon. So TripAdvisor, there's a guy called Uba Butler. So what he did is, he created a shed. So he turned his backyard or his shed into a restaurant. And he actually was able to create a restaurant by the name of My Shed on TripAdvisor, and he was able to kind of fake all the dishes by using cream and foam cream and foam wash. He was very innovative, so he just wanted to find out if TripAdvisor is actually verifying all of these restaurants that are posted on, that is there on their website. So what he did, he created a fake restaurant, he created fake reviews, and in a span of 15 days, he was able to bring up his restaurant as the number one restaurant in his area. And when he did up the first, on the first day when the restaurant launched or something happened, he got pre-cooked meals from another renowned restaurant, and then he also had reviews for those. So people are extremely innovative when it comes to these things. And of course, TripAdvisor denied it, but it also gives us a warning, or should we even trust online restaurants and reviews, right? Okay, so this is with Amazon. So what's the problem here is, so there are 4,000 reviews about a product, right? And thankfully, Amazon gives us some filters below. So what is the one indicator where we can find out if it is a genuine review or not is going by the verified purchase tag, right? So we filtered it out by the verified purchase tag, and there is not even a single review which is verified. And everything is 5-star, right? So yeah, so this is what human learning, so we are going to use all of this human learning that we saw, and we are going to create a machine learning model. So that's what we're going to do. So the next 15 minutes, I'm going to be talking about feature extraction, which is one of the major challenges when it comes to this sort of a problem. And how do we finally annotate or label all of these reviews by doing all of these feature engineering process. And finally, I'll talk about a bit of automation. So I've not covered automation much here because we have n number of algorithms that can solve the problem for us in this particular case. But the problem here is to first annotate the data set that we have as the data review as fake or not. So I have basically split the split the feature engineering extraction process or the features basis three nodes. So we have a reviewer who has posted, and then we have the actual review, and then we finally have we also can capture some network related information. Apart from this, we can also have product features, product centric features that you can go and look up or combine with this set of features. But in most of the cases, we found out that product features or product matching is not very much needed. So by and large, if you have to have a smaller subset of features with a better level of annotating, then these reviews or these features, feature centered around these nodes, were more than enough. So what are the reviewer-centric features that we're talking about here? So we have, so the first thing that we look at is, as we saw with the human learning process, so we did, we looked at the number of reviews by that particular reviewer and the number of shares he has received and time interval between reviews. So this is something which is available on the API side. So when you pick up, so ELP data set is very famous for this fake reviews identification. They do have a timestamp. So what is the time span between two posts of a same reviewer? So that is also an indicator. And then how many of his reviews are positive how many of his reviews are negative? And ratio of verified purchases. So is there a verified tag there when he posts the review? And he also verified stay will apply to TripAdvisor, so or Make My Trip reviews. And finally, rating deviation. So rating deviation is something like when you have a review where he has given a one-star rating. So what are the list of products he has listed one-star, and what is the list of products that he has named given five-star? And is his rating pattern, is there a pattern to his ratings? So that is what you'll get from rating deviation. And review length, of course. So review length will also be a reviewer-centric feature as well as a review-centric feature. We'll see how we can match the both. So now let's look at the review-centric features. So review-centric features, you can have our maximum content similarity. So the first thing that we do is we look for near duplicates. So near duplicates are something when you have, when you try and do, so this can be done using some measure like cosine similarity or Jaccard similarity or some sort of a clustering where you're trying to group similar documents together. So there are again different types of near duplicates. So duplicate reviews posted from different IDs and then same reviewer posting in different reviews for different products, but the content is the same. And then the reviewer is posting the same review for the same product, which means like he's spamming, we can say. So on every day, he comes and posts a review for that product, which is the same. So there are different types of duplicates with which you can identify all of these, near duplicates. And then because this is where we'll be using a lot of NLP, where it is really helpful, you can also find the percentage of nouns, pronouns, adjectives, and verbs. So basically, this can be done using a part of speech tagging. So that will give you the output of all of these. So fake reviews have a tendency, if you have a lot of pronouns in your review, then it's more likely to be a fake review. So that again depends on what sort of domain you're looking at and what sort of corpus you have in hand. But by and large, when you have a lot of pronouns and when you have a lot of adjectives, right? So some way you are not very happy. So when you say it's an extremely horrific place, and then you have a list of adjectives which you have listed without really mentioning what you were really unhappy about, right? So that is a seemingly fake review. So we have a lot of features which we can derive out of the review in itself for us to identify if it is a fake review or not. And we also have lexical validity. So lexical validity is the measure of how many number of you have meaningful English words vis-a-vis the number of non-English characters that you have. Say, for example, you might have a lot of links, you may have a lot of punctuations, you may have 100 dots after great, right? So all those things goes into lexical validity. Lexical diversity is how many unique words do you have in your corpus? If your review is 100 words, have you been repeating the same words over and over again in your review? And Content diversity is, again, when you have how many different nouns and pronouns do you have with respect to the adjectives and adverbs. So there is a lot of calculations that you can, combinations that you can try with all of these features. And you can also find out if it is an active or a passive voice. So these are some of the ways in which you can identify the review-centric features. And if a review has a picture or a link, then again, that means it is a it is an authentic review, right? So, and other things which we can do are emotiveness, and then we have something called linguistic inquiry and word count, which is a tool with, or a software which gives you a list of 58 features that can be used to, only text-specific features that can be used to identify if a review is seemingly fake or not, right? And we can also look at some of the network-centric features. So some of the network-centric features are you can capture the IP address, you can also capture the GPS information, and you can also see a timestamp, and you can see if there is a pattern to it, to that timestamp, or the pattern to the way the reviewer is posting. And you can also do traffic patterns. So whenever there is a spam network, right, so they're usually closely knit, and so they come, all these reviews during a given period of time or at a specific interval of time come from the same neighborhoods, IP neighborhoods. So that can be another information, and we can also see from which device they are posting. And so typical behavior pattern of a actual reviewer and a suspicious reviewer. So this sort of analysis can also be included in your fake review detection. So proposed framework, it is very simple. So if you have an unlabeled data, so we are not going to clean the data like how we do for a sentiment analysis, where we go remove numbers, punctuations. We should not be doing any of that. We should be looking at the data as is. So we should, the best and the least normalization that we can do is we can remove everything into lowercase, and if there are any spell errors, we're going to correct it. Because every information that is there in the review when it comes to spam, identifying spam is really important. So when it comes to pre-processing, we're going to do only these things. And then the feature engineering is going to be all the list of features that we spoke about, and finally we are going to annotate or label the review. Finally, what we're going to do after we have the labeled data, we're going to put it through classification algorithms for automation. So this is similar to any sort of classification approach that we follow, but the only problem is here we're going to again have a skewed data. So we're going to be dealing with an imbalanced data set. So again, we can use a lot of sampling techniques like SMOT or any other traditional technique, upsampling, downsampling, and all of these things to make the classes balanced, and then we can go and try our accuracy and evaluate our model. So this is with the label, once we have the label data. And what should be the future? So future is, I think in my opinion, whenever we do a sentiment analysis model, we should always have a pipeline. So the first thing that is that should be there in your pipeline should be your spam review classification. Right, so we should be doing that first, and then analyze the rest of all genuine reviews for any sort of sentiments or themes or topics that we're trying to pick up from there. Right, and when we do, if we want to combine the both together, along with sentiment analysis, if you're extracting the features, you already have the sentiment, right? So you can again classify them as fake positive, fake negative, and then you can do your analysis. So you can also look at the list of, you can also plot a word cloud and see what are the words that are there in a fake positive review, fake negative review. So there's a lot of experimentation and research that can go in when you combine this spam along with the traditional sentiment analysis model. On that note, I'm finally there in the last bit. So what should be the future? So future, I think it is, it's going to be a war between fake versus fact. And we are talking about explainable AI, we are talking about Industry 4. We should also be talking about responsible AI. When we talk about responsible AI, all of us are directly or indirectly responsible for the content that's getting posted online, right? So so as vendors or as marketplaces like Amazon, they should also have completely understand the industry, and also to the benefit of all the consumers, they should have strict measures to understand and weed off all of these fake reviews. And as reviewers, let's not post any negative reviews, let's not spam reviews, and also let's not remove a review if somebody says we'll give you a 10% discount, which is very common these days. And as ML practitioners, we also have to come up with ways in identifying all of these, because there's not much process. Like, we have BERT, we have neural networks, we have all of that, but we should also be looking at this problem, and we should be, so we have Google, and we also have Facebook for giving us models like Prophet, BERT, and all those things, Google Brain. So let's take our, take it as our responsibility and solve and research on this area and find out models which help us identify fake reviews better. On that note, I'd like to end my speech. And sorry, I had to talk the entire 30 minutes. Are we allowed for a few questions? Else I'm available outside for questions.